again out of this book of mysteries with Jonathan Kahn. I think because there's Hebrew background or something, I don't know, I just, each page I find myself going, I just have to think about it. But it's called The Double. In ancient times, said the teacher, on the holiest day of the year, Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, a unique ceremony took place. The high priest would stand before the people with two goats at his side. Each goat had to be identical in appearance to the other. The high priest would then reach into an urn and pull out two lots, one in each hand. Each lot had a different Hebrew word inscribed on it. He then placed one lot on the head of the goat to his right and another on the head of the goat to his left. One stone identified the goat that would die as the sacrifice for the sins of the people. The other identified the goat that would be let go. So before there could be a sacrifice, there had to be the presentation of the two goats before the people, the apportioning of the two destinies. What about the Messiah? Before his sacrifice, what took place? He was presented before the people for choosing, for the appointing of destinies. And there had to be two presented, I said, so there had to be two men presented before the people. Exactly. The only one, and only one, could become the sacrifice. So Messiah had to be one of the two lives presented before the people in order to be chosen as the sacrifice. And according to the ordinance of Yom Kippur, the other life had to be let go. So what happened to the other life that was presented that day? He was let go. Yep. And what was his name?
Barabbas.
According to the requirements of the ancient ceremony, two goats or lives had to be identical. Messiah, the Son of God, the Son of the Father. Do you know what the name Barabbas means? No. Barabbas comes from two Hebrew words, bar, which means son, and abba, which means father. Barabbas means son of the Father. Two lives, each one bear the name Son of the Father. So the sacrifice and the one set free, and the one set free because of the sacrifice, must in some way be identical. So if God were to die in your place, he would have to become like me. He would have to become like you, of flesh and blood, in the likeness of sin. He would become your identical. So your mission today is to live today as one sentenced to judgment, but who instead has been set free and given a second chance of life because of the love and the sacrifice of him. And then it gave a couple scriptures, and you can write these down. I don't have them marked to read them. Leviticus 16, 7 through 10, which talks about the goats and how they had to offer them. And then Matthew 27, 15 through 24, which talks about when Jesus was before Pilate and they chose. But I thought that was very interesting that Barabbas and the Messiah were identical. Amen. They were the Son of the Father.
Amen.
Anyway.
That's good.
Anyone have any prayer requests or testimonies this evening? Mike?
Cindy did come home Monday. Our daughter from Kansas brought her home. Each day, the pain level is getting less and less and less. So the healing is in the process. And we're watching the healing that we've been praying for manifest. So praise the Lord for that.
Amen.
Thank the Lord.
Amen.
Can't wait to see her here.
Amen. She can't wait to be here. She's watching right now.
Hi, Cindy. Anyone else? Well, let's stand and pray, thanking him for Cindy's healing and
yes,
praying for those that couldn't be here tonight for whatever reason. A lot of times, you know, at the end of the day, it's really hard. The devil's makes you very tired at the end of the day.
Yeah.
But I'm praying that we stir up the gift in us, that we have that desire to get here, because it's when we come together that we stir each other up
Amen.
For what we're here for.
Amen.
we love you tonight, and we thank you for the privilege that we get to gather here in your name to lift you up, God, and to know you like we know you, that your finished work on the cross, because you were the sacrifice, God, that it is finished, and we thank you for all the healings that are manifest because of that, and we thank you for the testimonies, God, that we get to hear and we get to share because of what you finished on the cross, all for your glory, God. We thank you for it tonight, for such a privilege that we get to be a part of these last days, for such a time as this, that we get to be your voice and your hands. Use each one of us to the fullest that you have purposed each one of our lives for. In your mighty name, Jesus, we thank you for it. Thank you, Jesus. For the offering, right?
After the word.
Okay. See if I can do it without messing it up. Let's speak the word.
Will we not rise again, that your people may rejoice in you.
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues, lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. I don't think so. I just barely tapped it.
To the left one. It's locked.
No, it's not.
To the right one.
There. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. And Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah. Glory.
Ron, would you want to come do the offering, please?
Bless you, my soul, and back to you. Say it. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we bless you tonight. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for meeting all of our needs. Thank you for touching and healing Cindy. Thank you, Lord, for your provision, for your protection, for being an ever-present help in the time of trouble. Lord, we just bless you tonight and exalt your name, the name that is above every name. And in that name, we celebrate tonight. In Jesus' name, praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you all for being here tonight. God bless you. Praise God. Thanks, Tammy, for opening. Good job. Good word. Mike, James, as always, appreciate you guys. Thank the Lord. Amen. A little quiet tonight, but it's probably because we had this cold spell that came through here today. Cold snap, praise the Lord. But, amen. Hey, Friday it's going to be nearly 70 degrees. It's supposed to be nice all weekend, so, amen. Get out on the porch or the backyard or the deck or whatever you got. Get outside and enjoy it. Praise the Lord. I know some of you are probably wondering if I had a date for Valentine's Day, and the answer is yes, February 14th. Okay, praise God.
You got a heart to be smart there, don't you?
Thank you, James.
My husband remembered it that night when I gave him a card.
Bless his heart. Oh, hallelujah. That's just one of those deals. Like youth jokes, you know, they never get old.
Yeah.
Wish James was still up here for the drum roll. Okay, well, we better get on with this. Hallelujah. I'll be as brief as I can and still cover what needs to be covered tonight. I feel like the Lord's given me, so I want to start with Genesis chapter 28 and read verses 10 through 17. God is good. Amen.
All the time.
Praise the Lord. So Genesis chapter 28, verse 10. And Jacob went out from Beersheba and went toward Haran. And he lighted upon a certain place, and he tarried there all night because the sun was set. And he took of the stones of that place and put them up for his pillow and lay down in that place to sleep. He dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of God ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, thy father, God of Isaac. The land whereon thou liest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed. And thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth. Thou shalt spread abroad to the west, and to the east, and to the north, and to the south. And in thee, and in thy seed, shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Behold, I am with thee, and will keep thee in all places whither thou goest, and will bring thee again into this land, for I will not leave thee, until I have done that which I have spoken of to thee. And Jacob awaked out of his sleep, and he said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I knew it not. And he was afraid and said, how dreadful is this place? This is none other but the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. Praise the Lord. Matthew chapter 11 and verse 28. And I would just say that is a, as all the Old Testament is, types and shadows. And it's a type and a shadow of God being in us, and we didn't know it. Praise the Lord. That's what I was talking about Sunday. We have this theological understanding, but I don't think we always grasp emotionally and in our heart what we may accept intellectually. And that's what God is trying to get across, because I don't think until that really happens, until we really recognize this oneness that we have with God, are we going to be able to do what we need to have need to do in order for this end-time revival and all of those end-time prophetic words to come to pass. So I think that's why God is opening us up to this. And I think that's really why the message of grace came and has been here forever. But, I mean, we just really have understood it over the last several years. And the truth is, that's because how are we ever going to really be able to embrace this God and us being one unless grace comes first? Because we all know our faults. We all know that we're not perfect and we have our issues and all this. But God has dealt with all of that through grace so that he could be one with us. Amen. So the scripture says in Matthew, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Yes. So it's Jesus is saying, if you come to me, I'll give you rest. And part of the reason for rest is to allow a different kind of vision to develop, which is what I was talking about just a moment ago. It's also what I was talking about Sunday. And it's real rest is understanding that we are one with God. If we understand we're one with God, then we don't worry about us anymore.
Right.
We're not trying to fix us and trying to get ourselves in a position where God will accept us or God will do something for us. God's already in us,
Amen.
Has become one with us.
Amen.
There's no separation
That's
between
right.
us and God. We are one thing. Amen.
Amen.
So it's like Jacob waking up from his sleep. And all of a sudden, we realize the bigger context of our lives. Before that, he was just a guy
right.
on his way out of town, basically.
Uh-huh.
And he falls asleep, and he sees this whole spiritual reality that he hadn't even understood. And when he wakes up, he goes, God's here.
Yeah.
And I didn't know it.
Uh-huh.
God's here all the time,
yeah.
and I didn't know it.
Exactly.
Right? So that's what he's happening. Surely the Lord is in this place, he said, and I wasn't aware of it. Surely the Lord is in this place, and a lot of times we're just not aware of it. And for a long time, even after we were born again, we understand that, but we're still doing things like trying to get God to come.
Right.
But he can't get any closer to you than he is.
Right.
He and you are one.
Yes.
You're one
yes.
thing.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. You're one reality. Amen. So because it hasn't been our normal state, it seems weird to us. I mean, it seems kind of contradictory almost. But resting strengthens your sensitivity to God's presence. Yes. The more you rest in Jesus, the more aware you can be of him and less aware of yourself.
Exactly.
The less you're focused on you, your faults, your needs, your whatever, and the more you can focus on the reality of Christ in you. Amen?
Amen.
So the pursuit of rest is really the pursuit of God.
Yes.
It's really trying to identify God's reality in your life. The purpose or the aim is to increase our awareness of our oneness with God.
Right.
I'm going to tell you, you know, I got born again in a Pentecostal church and holiness church, and it was all, you know, a lot of stuff. And we got really involved in the church, and we did a lot of things. And I won't go through all of that, but I still always felt like you had to do more. You know, there was always more that had to be done. And I'm not saying we shouldn't do things. I'm just saying our motive ought to be different than what it is.
Right.
And I have this thing with the two youngest of Allison's kids, our grandkids. They're two boys. And at the time when I would do this, I still do occasionally, but when I first was doing it, they were like 2 and 3, 1 and 2. And they always wanted to get a hug and a kiss goodbye, you know, whenever they were at the house and they were leaving. And so I'm kind of ornery with them. I love their boys, you know, so I just mess with them. And I'm a bit of a germaphobe, so this is unusual for me. And it kind of freaked Sally out the first time I did it, and my daughter for that matter. But they come to give me a kiss, and I'd pick them up, and I'd blow in their mouth. They kind of got, you know, expecting just a kiss on the lips, and I just blow in their cheeks blow up, you know. And then I suck it back out. Now, that sounds disgusting, but they're a little kid. They're my grandkids, you know?
Right.
And it's like the Lord said, you got it. You breathed into them and then took their breath back into you. You become one for that moment.
Yes.
Breath in, breath out.
Yes.
There you go.
You're giving them your life, and they're giving their life back.
Uh-huh.
So for a split second, you know, you're like, one thing,
yes,
one entity. And it really made me think differently about the Lord and about the relationship we have with us, because that's what he did with Adam. He breathed the breath of life into him. And then as Jesus, you know, Jesus breathed on the disciples. Jesus was drawing from the Father and giving back to us. He became one.
Yes.
And he lived his life that way. He lived,
yes,
his life one with the Father. Now, we always look at him as this prototype, this thing, but we never really, you know, the way we've tried to, you know, be like him was to do good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of realizing that what he did was like what Tammy was saying here a week ago, or maybe it was Suzanne, I can't remember, Suzanne, I guess, but I and my Father are one. I only do what I see my Father do. I only say what I hear my Father say.
Mm-hmm.
Well, how can he do anything else? Because they're one. Now, we get all, you know, wrapped up, and I got a word from the Lord. Listen, everything that goes through you,
exactly,
is God.
Yes.
It's just a question of how you interpret it.
Exactly.
Right.
So if you realize that it's God is always talking, when you're talking, it's God talking.
Yes.
Right.
You can't separate the two of you. It would change the dynamic so much in the way that we live our lives as,
yes,
Christians. We'd quit trying to be Christians, and we would just be.
Yes.
You can't be anything else.
Yes.
I mean, there's no way you can be anything else. You and God are one.
Yes.
Right.
So we put too much, the more we try, the more human we are. You know, the more,
mm-hmm,
fleshly we are. I'm not saying fleshly is always bad. I'm just saying it isn't what we really are. When we just relax and go through our life, God just operates.
Yes.
He just does what he does.
Yes.
And we don't have to work at it. We don't have to try to, you know, get up in the morning and pray a long prayer that hopefully God will do something in my life. How can he not do something,
exactly,
in your life? He, you and him,
exactly,
are one.
Come on.
Exactly.
Praise the Lord. So anyway, the purpose or the aim is to increase this awareness of God. So if you can, Mike, go back to Genesis chapter 28 and verse 12. Actually, 12 through 15. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached heaven. And behold, the angels of God ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, he's in this place where God always is anyway, but he didn't know it. God starts speaking. And he says, behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, thy father, God of Isaac, land whereon thou liest, to thee will I give it, to thy seed. Verse 14 and 15, yes, and thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth, and thou shalt spread abroad to the west, to the east, to the north, to the south, and thee and thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Behold, I am with you, will keep thee in all places whither thou goest, and will bring thee again to this land, for I will not leave thee until I've done that which has been spoken of. That's what I said yesterday, too. As long if you're alive, your destiny isn't complete.
Right.
It's only once your destiny has been fulfilled that you don't exist here anymore. You're still alive, but you're just not alive in this same realm.
Right.
So people say, well, I don't know what my destiny is. Don't worry about it. You've got one or you wouldn't be here.
Exactly.
I mean, when it's done, it's done.
Sure.
You just move on.
Yes.
So that's number one. So God speaks to us when we turn our attention to him.
Yes.
So in other words, if our attention's on God all the time, then God's talking all the time.
Yes.
It's just that we only are aware of his presence at certain times, so we think we only hear him certain times.
Right.
When in fact, the more we are aware of his presence, the more we hear.
Yes.
It isn't like he talks for a while and then he stops. He's always speaking to us,
yes,
but we're only aware of that occasionally.
Yes.
Jesus was constantly, totally aware of God's presence. And that's why he could say what he said. And that's also, by the way, why he could do what he did.
Amen.
Because he was a man,
amen,
one with God. He was identical to you and I.
Yes.
He operated as a man filled with God.
Yes.
And that's what happens with each one of us when we get born again. We get born from above the same way Jesus was born from above.
Amen.
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 That's the reality. So most of what passes for listening today isn't really listening at all. It's just a pause between our sentences.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, if we're really not listening, we're just talking until we get a chance to talk some more.
Uh-huh.
Praise the Lord. John chapter 15, verses 3 through 5. John 15, 3 through 5. Now you're clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing. Jesus could have said this the very same thing about himself. In fact, he did. He just said it in a different way. About, I and the Father are one. I only do what the Father does. I only say what the Father says. He's saying that's how it works for everybody. Amen. Because he said, I got to go back to the Father so I can send my Spirit so you can do what I do, and greater things than these will you do. But you got to abide in me. You got to stay aware of this oneness that you have,
yes,
with me,
yes,
which is the Father, right? He was God in the flesh. Hold on. So are you.
Yes, we are.
Yes.
Yes, we are.
If you're not, then this is all a bunch of hooey.
Exactly.
He was the firstborn,
yes,
of the brethren.
Yes,
Lord.
We were born again. We are now. He was the fullness of the Godhead dwelt in him bodily, and we are complete in him.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
It's the same. And I know, you know, I said Sunday, and I'm just saying it again, because I know it's uncomfortable to even say that, because that's not what the way we normally think about it. But that's also why we're not accomplishing everything Jesus said we were supposed to accomplish.
Yes.
He said it this way, and we ought to see it the same way. He said he didn't see it as robbery to call himself equal with God.
Right.
But he humbled himself as a man.
Mm-hmm.
Right? To serve others.
Right.
So we shouldn't be uncomfortable with saying that we're equal with God in that sense. We're not the creator, but we have the creator, and us are now one, just the same,
yes,
as it was with Jesus.
Yes.
So we have to change the way that we think about things, or we won't ever act any differently.
Right.
You can't do anything you're not thinking, right?
Right.
So that's the whole point of all this that we're talking about here. So to abide is what? What does that mean? It means to stay. Right?
Right.
Another word for that is abode. That's your home. Right? Your abode is where you abide. It's where you stay.
It is.
Amen. God stays. We are his abode.
Yes.
We are his temple.
Glory.
We are the flesh that God fills with his spirit.
Thank you, Lord.
We become one. And Jesus said you have to abide. You have to stay in that reality in order to produce any kind of fruit. Because if you don't, then it's you trying to do something that you can't do unless you're abiding.
Glory.
Unless you're this oneness in this one place with God. Yeah. So it's what the Spirit did. He gives us a picture of this when Jesus was baptized. Look at this in John chapter 1, verses 31 through 33. It's exactly what the Spirit did, and it's what the Spirit is doing with us. It was symbolic for Jesus, but at the same time, it was showing the truth. It was showing what was really happened, what had really happened, and it was showing us what happens when we receive the Holy Spirit, when we get born again. The Spirit abides. It stays. It doesn't ever go.
Right.
It's the seal.
Amen.
It's the thing that says we're one.
Yes.
It's God's Spirit. It's not something different. It's not something separate. It's not a lesser part. It's God. Amen. Yes. So I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. So this was just to manifest the reality that Jesus was God in the flesh. And John bare record saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it did what?
Abode.
It abode on him.
Yeah.
In other words, it abided there. It stayed there. Because he goes on to say, and I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, go on to 35. So he abode, he says in verse 34. I think you're in the wrong one now. It's John 1. I'm sorry, it was 1, 31 through 33. Okay, and I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom now shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining, the same as he which was baptized with the Holy Ghost, or the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
So it's a picture of what happens to us when we get born again. The Holy Spirit comes, and it stays, it abides.
Yes.
And we have to abide in it. In other words, we have to stay conscious of that reality if we're going to do what Jesus did.
Yes.
Just because we were born again and just because we have the same reality as Jesus doesn't mean we're going to act on it. Jesus acted on it because he was sure of it.
There you go.
The Spirit is upon me because I'm anointed for this purpose. In other words, I'm here for that reason. So are we.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
Jesus speaks of rest as something that we find. He said, come unto me and I'll give you rest.
Yes.
So he talks about it as something that you find. And it's found in our awareness of being one with him.
Yes.
There is no other rest that's going to amount to anything. There's all kinds of stuff that we call rest.
Sure.
But it's not really rest.
Sure.
It's leisure activities. It's sitting around. It's whatever. But it doesn't produce anything.
Right.
It's just idle time.
Sure.
This rest is a rest of accomplishment.
There you go.
We rest, but God is working all the time that we're resting him.
Yes.
Amen? So, again, John 15, this time verses 15 and 16. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth. But I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you. He's saying the same thing about us that he said about himself. Ye have not chosen me, but I've chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it you.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So remember, I said this a couple weeks ago. I don't even remember now the whole message we were talking about walking with God. But you can't walk with God unless you agree with God.
You
can't walk with somebody that you're not agreeing with.
Right?
Right?
Right.
You can't walk with somebody that you're not agreeing with because you'll have different destinations, you'll have a different route, you'll have issues that keep you from actually walking together. Another way of saying that is walking as one.
Yes.
Have the same destination,
Amen.
Have the same purpose, have the same path, right? That's just being one with God. So God's presence in us introduces a new operating principle in us. That is what religion calls sanctification. Now let me just say that again. our awareness of God's presence in us, us knowing this, focusing on it, it opens up or introduces a whole new operating principle, a whole new way of operating. Amen?
Amen.
And that is what religion calls sanctification or separation, separated unto God, one with God. And sanctification also means out of that comes you're holy, you're righteous, you're like Jesus.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
You're like God in the flesh.
Yes.
Your flesh has been sanctified. How is it sanctified? By God's presence.
Thank you, Lord.
God has sanctified you. He has made you righteous so his presence can be one with you. See, we make all kinds of noise about sanctification, and it all becomes just words without realizing all of this stuff is pointing us to the same thing, this oneness with God. Because until we grasp that, until we understand, see, that was the message Jesus brought. It wasn't a message of get better, be better, and do better. It was a message of God has, by grace, sanctified you for him. So that you can be one. He has breathed his life into you so that it is one life now. That's why Jesus said, or Paul said, it's not me that lives anymore. I've been crucified with Christ. It's not me that lives anymore, but it's Christ lives in me.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen? We have to understand that. God's presence in us introduces this whole new paradigm or this whole new way of looking at our lives and looking at the way God wants to work through us. Amen? You're either alive in the Spirit. Paul told the Galatians, he said, you started out in the Spirit.
Uh-huh.
You got to stay in the Spirit because you can't do this stuff in the flesh.
Exactly.
Why? Because the flesh is dead.
Yes.
The flesh is this realm, this world, amen, that Satan is the god of.
Right.
Amen. That's why he attacks your flesh. He doesn't attack your spirit because he can't touch it.
Right.
He can't overcome it. It's God. So he's got to get you in the flesh. He's got to get you thinking not like God, but like just a flesh person, because then he got control over you.
Right.
You're alive because of the God life that's in you. The Spirit is life.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen? And without that knowledge, you become susceptible to the enemy's lies.
Yes.
It's death. It's spiritual death. It's what happened to Adam and Eve.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? So that's all because of the fall. So it's because of that, just think in terms of the way the world is, okay? It's like the entire universe is predatory. The older you get, the more you'll understand what I'm talking about. Amen? It feeds itself on the death of everything that it gives birth to.
Right.
True.
Why? Because it's fallen.
Mm-hmm.
It's dead to begin with.
Uh-huh.
That's why we got to have a new heaven and a new earth. It's why we have to be made brand new.
Right.
Because otherwise we're dead. We're still a part of this predatory system that's just, it's cannibalistic. It just feeds on itself.
Yes.
It destroys its own. Everybody freaking out about global warming and everything. I'm not worried about any of that stuff.
No.
Praise the Lord. It's what we would expect.
Yes.
Right.
Under the fallen conditions of this planet. Praise the Lord. So, It's not hard to think that something evil is involved in that.
Right.
Because it's not like God. It's not like the way God created it.
Right.
All right? Neither is man. Unless he gets born again so that God can get back into him,
yes.
It's dead.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. You see what I'm saying?
Yep.
All right. Romans 8, chapter 19, or excuse me, Romans chapter 8, verses 19 through 29. Satan is the god of this world. He's the god of the dead.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Jesus said his word is spirit.
Yes.
And it's life. Because the spirit is the life of God. That's why he gives us his spirit. God gives us his life. He ruachs into us his life.
Yes.
His breath, his spirit. Same word. So for the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. Why? Because it's in this predatory realm.
Right.
And it's waiting for God life. It's dead and it's waiting for life to come to it. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who has subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption or death, the glory into the glorious liberty of the children of God, or into God life. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. That's all we're seeing. And not only they, but ourselves also, which had the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our bodies.
Right.
Yes.
Why? Because right now it's a constant battle, just like it was for Jesus.
Right.
It's a constant battle to renew our minds to who and what we really are, so that our bodies, or this dead part, doesn't try to control.
Uh-huh.
For we are saved by hope, but hope that isn't seen is not hope. But what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Likewise, the Spirit, life, also helpeth our infirmities. Why? It heals us. It delivers us if we're constantly aware of it. It's like somebody was talking about, I think it was Jane Sunday said, you know, we're always wanting a miracle. If we understood this God thing, we would just be blessed. We don't need miracles. You don't need a miracle if you're blessed. If you're walking in blessing, you don't need a miracle.
Right.
The miracle has to come when you're outside of that, when something happens to cause you
exactly.
to get trapped in the dead stuff.
Right.
Come on.
The flesh.
True.
Then you got to have a miracle.
Yes. If
that is a suspension of the death, of the normal realm of this life.
Yes.
That's all it is. It suspends the laws of nature, of the natural man.
Uh-huh.
Yep.
But blessings, you just walk in blessings.
Yes.
You don't need miracles.
Exactly.
That's why Jesus walked, amen, in the blessing.
Come
yes.
on.
That's what God's telling Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He said, I want to be in you so that you can be blessed to be a blessing, so you can release God life
yes.
to everybody else,
yes.
ultimately through Jesus Christ. But if we hope for that, we see not. Okay, likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose, just another way of saying blessing. If you're blessed, even when bad stuff happens, the blessing still prevails.
Yes.
It'll always overcome whatever the negative is.
Yes.
Amen. For whom he did foreknow, that'd be you and I.
Amen.
He also did predestinate.
Yes.
For what? To be conformed to the image of his Son.
Yes.
God-man.
Yes.
Amen. That he might be the firstborn among many brethren. That's the Bible. That's the gospel. That's the good news.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise the Lord. So on the one hand, we live in a world that's dead. And at the same time, by virtue of our oneness with Christ, we are seated in heavenly places. We are in the spirit realm.
Amen.
Yes.
That's called God manifest in the flesh.
Amen.
That's what Jesus did, didn't he? He came from the heavenlies and entered into this realm.
Yes.
He had to have a man. He had to have a body to do that.
God
had to have flesh in order to operate legally in this realm.
Yes.
That's why we are
here.
For God to be manifest.
Yes.
For his image to be revealed.
Yes.
For his blessings to be blessings for everybody.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So, we're seated. Another way of saying that is we're seated with him in heavenly places. We live in a dead world, but we are life. We're the life in this dead realm.
Yes.
Praise God. All right, 2 Samuel, let me show you something. Again, Old Testament is types and shadows, right? So 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 1 through 3. Came to pass that when the king sat in his house and the Lord had given him rest round about from all his enemies, that the king said unto Nathan the prophet, see now I dwell in a house of cedar, but the ark of God dwelleth within curtains. And Nathan said to the king, go, do all that is in thine heart, for the Lord is with thee. So again, types and shadows. God gave him rest. Why? Because God was with him. defeated his enemies. He was blessed. What does David do? Wants to give him a house. Wants to give him a place to reside. Right?
Yeah.
Everything David touched seemed to bear the mark of God. The God who gave him rest from his enemies.
Uh-huh.
Now, look at this. 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 5 through 7. Though. How does God respond to this? Go and tell my servant David, he's talking to the prophet Nathan again. He says, thus saith the Lord, shalt thou build me a house for me to dwell in? You're going to build me a house? Whereas I have not dwelt in any house since the time that I brought up the children of Israel out of Egypt, even to this day. But I have walked in a tent and in a tabernacle. And in all the places wherein I have walked with all the children of Israel, spake I a word with any of the tribes of Israel whom I commanded to feed my people Israel, saying, why haven't you built me a house?
Yeah.
It's basically what he's saying.
Yeah.
He said, did you ever hear me say anything about, I want you to build me a house?
Right.
I understand your motivation, David. But have I ever asked you for anything like that? Because God wants to be in people,
yes, he does.
Not in a building.
Exactly.
That's the point he's trying to get across to David. Now, he eventually lets them build a house, but it was just a type. It was just a shadow
right.
of what he really wanted.
Right.
He wants to be in us. He wants to be one with us. He doesn't want to be a destination that we go to twice a week.
Right.
Or he doesn't want to be something that's just kind of out there for us to try to find. He wants to be one with us. He wants to be inseparable from us. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 4 through 7. For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon that mortality might be swallowed up of life. See, our spirit knows. It knows that our flesh should be like our spirit. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Which is what Jesus is now.
Right.
After the resurrection. He still has a body.
Right.
But it's a perfect match for his spirit.
Right.
That's the struggle that we're in, the same that he had.
Right.
So, our spirit is groans. And why? Not that we would be unclothed, not that we wouldn't have a body, but that we would have a body that would be
right.
like God, like the spirit of God that's in us, so that our spirit and our body would be the same.
Uh-huh.
Amen. Now he that hath wrought us for the self same thing, he that made us for that purpose is God. He, the one that makes us feel that way, is God. The thing that makes us think that is the God that's in us, that's one with us,
mm-hmm.
who also hath given unto us the earnest of the Spirit. Therefore, we are always confident, knowing that while we're at home in the body, we're absent from the Lord. You understand what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
We're still one, but there's a sense of disconnect
right.
because of the flesh.
Right.
So he's trying to get us past that by explaining this to us. For we walk by faith. Not by sight, because we look in the mirror and we see this and it doesn't look like God. It doesn't act like God. It doesn't seem like God. So we have to do this by faith. That's the reason we walk by faith. Not so that we get a miracle here and a miracle there and we get this thing and that thing so we can, you know, heal people and all that. We walk by faith so that we are conscious, aware by faith that we are like Jesus. We are God in flesh.
Yes.
If we got that, if we walk by faith, then the healings come naturally, automatically, because it's just the flow of abiding in him, the fruit produces.
Yes.
It just comes. See, we've got it all backwards. We're trying to make stuff happen outside of this reality.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And every scripture that we read it backwards. We end up thinking it's about trying to get the flesh to do something that the flesh is incapable of doing.
Exactly.
We abide in the Spirit. The Spirit works through us. Just the same, the exact same
yes.
way it worked through Jesus.
Yes.
Exactly the same.
Yes.
The only difference is Jesus had a total consciousness of it, a total
yes.
awareness of it.
Yes.
He was steeped in the reality. He was the Word made flesh.
Yes.
So we renew our minds to the Word of God so that we can operate the same way. Mm-hmm. All right? Faith, it's about faith, walking by faith. It's about faith in our oneness with God.
Amen.
It's how we're to walk. It's how we have to walk. It's a walk of rest. It's a walk of faith, not sight. It's a walk of the Spirit and not a fleshly house.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord. Some of you know I'm a big Mark Twain fan. I love everything Civil War stuff, but historically. But Mark Twain, I've got a bunch of books by him as well as biographies of him. And he once said, heaven goes by favor. If it went by merit, you would stay out and your dog would go in.
That's true.
Dogs don't have agendas, you know. I mean, they're just dogs. They just love.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right? They have virtue simply because they don't know any better.
Right.
So look at Zephaniah chapter 3, verses 17 to 20. I think of that every time I hear Jesus, you know, he says we're not to give bread to the dogs. But the dog got healed, right? I mean, she says, but even the little puppies, you know, even the dogs eat from the crumbs of the master's table. And Jesus said, how great is your faith?
Uh-huh.
You were healed.
Yeah.
The dog got in. And all of the people were standing out there trying and got nothing, right?
There you go.
Because it's not about virtue. It's not about us. It's about God's favor.
Yes.
Amen.
So the Lord thy God in the midst of thee is mighty. He will save. He will rejoice over thee with joy. He will rest in his love. He will joy over thee with singing. I will gather them that are sorrowful for the solemn assembly who are of thee, to whom the reproach of it was a burden. Behold, at that time I will undo all that afflict thee. I will save her that halteth and gathereth her that was driven out. And I will get them praise and fame in every land where they have been put to shame. At that time will I bring you again, even in that time that I gather you, will I make you a name and a praise among all people of the earth, when I turn back your captivity before your eyes, saith the Lord.
Amen.
So God sings over us because he has crowned us with glory and honor.
Amen.
Himself.
Glory.
He has crowned us with glory and honor. He has crowned us with him.
Yes.
And he sings over us. Praise the Lord. Look at John chapter 1, verse 32 and 33. Just like my grandchildren. He wants to be one with them.
Uh-huh.
That's the reality. They're me. They were in me.
Yes.
Come on.
Before I was. Me.
Yes.
Right?
Right.
Before the foundation of the world, he says, we were in Christ.
Uh-huh.
He wants to be one with us. He wants that reality. He wants that to be the reality. And he doesn't want it to just be a fact without us experiencing it, without us knowing it and enjoying it the way he does.
Uh-huh.
So John bare record saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon him whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizes with the Holy Ghost. Crowning us, God comes like he did on Jesus, right? Matthew chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him, the Spirit of God, and lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. That's what God is shouting over us.
Yes.
The Spirit has come. The Spirit came to us the same as it came to Jesus.
Yes.
There it was a picture for everybody to see. For us, it comes the same way, though.
Yes.
God breathes. God gives us his life. And then he shouts. I was right here at this altar, I don't know how long ago, 8, 10 years ago, and I've talked about this before, and I heard God say it out loud. I mean, like an audible voice. Thou art my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. I looked around to see who else was in here that he could have been talking to. And I thought, the first thought that came to me, like every time the word comes to you, the enemy tries to steal the word, right?
Right.
So the word came, and immediately, I knew it was real. It was like in me. It was so real. And I thought, you're just remembering a scripture. And the Lord said, why do you think you have that scripture? God says the same thing about every one of us.
Yes.
If he said that about Jesus, he says it about us.
Yes.
Glory.
And that word son is gender neutral.
Yes.
He's just talking about you're my child.
Yes.
In whom I am well pleased.
Yes, Lord.
Or I wouldn't call you my child.
Exactly.
I wouldn't be one with you. Mm-hmm. Amen. All right. Let's look at Psalms 8. Verses 4 through 6. Psalms 8, verses 4 through 6. Just a couple scriptures here and we'll wrap up. Psalms chapter 8, verses 4 through 6. What is man that thou art mindful of him? The son of man that thou visitest him? Thou hast made him a little lower than the angels and hast crowned him with glory and honor. And he was singing over us when he did it.
Uh-huh.
Thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Yes. He's given us God authority in a human being.
Absolutely.
All right. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 9. Hebrews 2, verse 9. But we see Jesus. Now, David wasn't talking about Jesus necessarily. He was talking about humanity. We see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man,
glory.
The firstborn of every brethren. That's why Paul said we were crucified with him.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? I died with him, but yet I'm not. I rose again. I'm alive again. But it's not really me that's alive. It's God in me that's alive.
Yes.
Right? It's his God life now.
Yes.
And that's what he's talking about here. Amen. Crowned with glory and honor. God gives us the Holy Ghost, his life. And God sings over us, his beloved sons, in whom he is well pleased.
Mm-hmm.
Crowned with glory and honor.
Amen.
Awake to his presence.
Amen.
He's here.
Yes.
We just didn't know it.
Yes.
Amen. Give him a hand clap tonight. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Amen. So, I'm emphasizing this, and it's something that we need to focus on because it'll change your life. I know you hear preachers say it all the time, but this is something that will change your life because it will put God life back to work. Amen. It won't be your life anymore. It'll be God in you.
Amen.
Praise God. God bless all of you. Appreciate you being here tonight. Go in the power of his might. In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
put up back in there, and it's going to be their area. They're already starting to make decorations and everything to their youth oriented stuff. So Rita and I were talking about it, and I took care of it. Came to the conversation of another part.